So I'm going to do a bit of an introduction to the panelists. Bear with me while I go through this. I think it's important we build some context, background to who these folks are and why they're sitting on the panel today. So you are meant to see that. First and foremost, we're going to welcome Mike Hennessy. Mike Hennessy joins us from ScribbleLive. You can clap for him. Mike specializes in delivering scalable, sustainable revenue for high-growth B2B software companies, and we'll talk about what that means. It's not just cliche words. He's got a broad range of backgrounds, from sales and marketing to customer success. Mike's sales teams have consistently set quarterly and annual sales records. He's increased average deal sizes and much more. He's also a two-time Deloitte Fast 50, Fast 500 winner with two separate organizations, so we'll talk about how you take multiple organizations to success. Most recently, Mike was the VP of North American Sales for 24/7 Inc., California-based Sequoia Capital-backed company. He came there through a successful acquisition where he helped the management team grow sales and marketing. Prior to that, he led marketing and sales for Tuition, which was also a company that was acquired. He holds an MBA for Queens, postgraduate diploma in marketing communications from Seneca, and a bachelor's degree from Mount Allison University. Thanks, Mike. Dan? Dan Wardle is the Director of Business Development at Vidyard. We've had Vidyard people here in the past. Over the years, he's had several positions from company growth, being on the AE team, starting up the SME and EMEA markets. Prior to Vidyard, he was a senior AE at Salesforce. Thanks for leaving Salesforce. And prior to that, he was at BlackBerry, where he held several sales leadership roles. And this is quoting Dan, his proudest accomplishment is hiring me back in 2013.
Oh my God.
He wrote that, not me. And lastly, Ilana Shulman. Ilana is the director of sales at Clio. She oversees both the BDRs, business development reps, and the account representatives. We'll talk about why there's two different teams and how they've had their structure set up. Both teams are exclusively outbound and cater to small to medium-sized law firms across North America. Ilana started her sales management career in 2003 at Good Life, where she opened and managed new clubs from coast to coast. And then she drastically changed her career and moved on to Rogers in 2012, where she started as a sales rep and quickly moved into management roles. So we'll hear about some of her success, you know, moving up an organization like that. There she won several awards for top sales and even MVP for the work she did coaching sales reps on performance plans. As a hobby, Ilana enjoys staying active. She's a marathon runner, spin class addict, and tries to get to yoga when possible. And she's most proudest of her six-year-old son. Salespeople do have lives too.
What? Yeah.
Thank you, guys. Okay, so let's jump into it. Let's give the audience some context. Let's understand what your sales organizations are like. So I want to specifically start with Ilana. You mentioned BDRs, you mentioned ARs. I think it's a relatively unique team structure, specifically compared to Vidyard and ScribbleLive. So can you give us some background into what your team looks like, how many people on your team, and what does a day-to-day look like for your rep?
Yeah. So as you said, I do oversee two separate departments in the... over for me, it's a completely outbound process. Lots of changes, so it's only been around now for almost 2 years within 8 years of Clio. So the ARs is a complete sales cycle. So from cold calling into the small law firm, so anywhere from a solo up to seven users, cold calling getting, which is tough, which we'll talk about after, I'm sure, through to a lawyer to be able to get them excited about the product all the way into closing them. So not easy task, but very fun, very successful to get us to that point. And then I also oversee BDRs. So for the BDRs, it's anywhere over seven users at the law firm. And what we do is we make sure to qualify them as best as possible, educate the lawyers. There's usually a lot more people to talk to, so a lot of different touch points there. And then passing them off once qualified to the account executive, who would then close the deal. So this has been the process. So there's two, and then I also have approximately 10 on the other side for the ARs.
Perfect. So 10 ARs who are doing full cycle, mm-hmm. and then two BDRs who are passing on deals to
you. And growing.
And growing.
Yes, hiring.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. So Dan, you've recently taken over the sales development organization over there at Vidyard. Two-pronged question. One, can you also talk about, your team structure and how you intend on kind of growing and taking that team? But most importantly, do you agree with Clio's philosophy of having sales work full cycle, reps work full cycle sales? Why or why not?
Sounds good. Yeah, I'll answer the first part first, because the second part's a very different question. So our org structure is more similar to Salesforce. So we have an inbound team that's called Concierge. And even they're actually split into two, the Act Now Concierge, like 5 minute, give them a call right away. They just ask for a demo, get them on the phone right now, and get them in front of an AE within a couple days. Then there's the other MQLs. Maybe they filled out a form, downloaded a white paper, went to an event that we were at. If we were sponsoring an event like this, all of you would get a call in the next 2 days, that kind of thing. Then we have the BDR team, which is very similar to Ilana. So they are focused on the bigger customers. Who do our AEs want to target? Do we want to call Clio? I'm sure Steven's received a few calls over the last year, and targeting those companies where we find that they would have a good fit for Vidyard's product, and coordinating with the account executives. So the split between that team is about 8 on the concierge side and about 20 on the BDR side, split between Kitchener and Vancouver, just for time zone sake. And then they're aligned to account executives that are split up by segment. So whether they're small, medium enterprise, mid-market, or key accounts, and then also Europe versus North America, and then North America's East versus West. So pretty straightforward, typical SaaS sales model and team structure. On the question about, do we believe in end-to-end sales? I do believe it if it is a product that, I wouldn't call it transactional, but is a sale that is potentially easier, there's one or two buyers, whereas our product tends to have between 6 to 10 buyers at the same time. So to really get a deal done, you need to be talking to multiple business stakeholders across sales, marketing, internal communications, and even support now. And so to be able to get that done, it really can take, SME team is at minimum 30 days, whereas the large enterprise team is more a year. So when we're closing deals with Microsoft, there's 25, 50 people involved. That needs to be in a different person's hand. So it just depends on your business model, what your sales cycle looks like, and who your buyer is, to depend on whether you should have that end-to-end sales. Like Shopify Plus, if anyone's familiar with that, it's a great example of an end-to-end. You're selling to an individual shop owner, you're dealing with the CEO, it's a set price point. There's no reason to have separate teams. For us, it's a very different sales cycle, so we need that separation.
I want to ask a quick question, just because given how long you've been at Vidyard and you've seen how the organization has changed over time, you mentioned territories. So sales, Vidyard's gone through many different types of sales, and I'm curious to know when you knew it was time to alter your territories or how your sales team was structured. Was there anything that triggered that? Was it at the size you were, the type of customers you were selling to, the amount of products and different functions that you're selling to an organization? What triggered those changes in territories?
Yeah, so that was in my previous role before I was on the business development side. I was the head of the account executives, and it came to a point about almost 2 years ago, actually, now, where there was just too many AEs, and we were all like, oh, but I was talking to that guy last month. Oh, like just all this bitching, right? And it became overlap. And so we, at that point in time, our leader of the team decided, okay, let's create more geographical territories. We now realize that was actually a pretty big mistake. So it took us a year to get out of that, about 3 quarters.
Why was it a mistake?
Because the guy in Atlanta, we had two customers there. And so now he has all of the Southeast with two customers, and he had to build that. It's now paying rewards for him now. But that's been 2 years. And people in California were just like, just getting it all. And it was cheating almost. It actually ended up, funny story, not funny, but disappointing story. Once we got rid of territories and went to more regional base, like East versus West is time zone, and also segments based on size, those reps actually ended up being potentially some of our weaker reps, right? They were just getting the California leads, which is our predominant market. Back then, it was probably like 80% of our business. It's now about 50%. So you really have to watch out for that. So we then changed to more of a what we call borderless territories. You pick 200 accounts. If you're mid-market or SME, you pick 50 accounts. If you're a key account, still a lot of accounts. Like our one guy in key accounts, he's only sold to two and he's hit his quota. Like 50 is way too many, but you give them kind of this big territory that they can work within. It's not geographically based, it's just segment based, and allow them to focus on that. They also get round robin from all the other accounts because there's, you know, 75,000 accounts in our system. Only about 5,000 are assigned, if that, probably more 4,000. And so they're still reaping the benefits of all of those other leads that are coming in or that your BDR is targeting. Because your BDR is not only targeting your accounts, they can be targeting whatever they want. You know, they might be targeting Wrangle, they might be targeting Clio, they might be targeting ScribbleLive, you just never know. And those get round robin, and we have kind of an order there. Once again, split east versus west.
Thanks, Mike. I think you have an interesting structure where you're a bit of a mix of both, in terms of you don't necessarily have anyone dedicated to just business development and then closing, but rather AEs focusing on the entire deal cycle. So can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, so I think one of the interesting things about this whole conversation is that every company that I've been to, and I've been lucky enough to have different sales contexts, so big deal size, big target customer base, small deal size, small customer base, mid-size. I think the individual sales context and where the company is at that time is critical. So there's no, unfortunately, there's no one size fits all, right? So I remember when I joined Scribble, our CEO is a CFO, and as the GM, I have an EBITDA number and I have a CAC number. Does everyone know what CAC is? In SaaS, it's your customer acquisition cost, right? So so when we look at the cost that the company incurs to acquire a new customer, and our company doesn't value customer lifetime value as much as others, they look at it, first year revenue costs you $10. If it costs you $10 to acquire a customer and you're selling it for $9, your company's going to be out of business eventually. Or the valuation of the company will be set at a certain valuation, right? You have to be able to prove a model that your CAC is better than one or better than. So when I talked to Steve Johnson, when I got to, who's at Vidyard, I think, still, because I asked him this question, he's the CRO at Vidyard, and he usually starts the year at 1.2 or 1.4 and then eventually goes down because Vidyard has some operational efficiencies. So at Scribble, we have a great sales team that does the full cycle. And we try to keep our CAC at 1.2 or less. And we do very much the round robin kind of target account thing that you guys are talking about. We're not quite as evolved as a sales team yet as Vidyard is, but it seems to be working for us. And we have the right archetype of reps to be able to, for them to be able to manage. And we have great demand generation from Tim Peters, who's sitting over there, and Angie, who's out in the crowd as well. So it works for us at this time and this place of the company's evolution based on the goals that we're trying to achieve to increase the valuation of the company. It may change down the road, right? So I think everyone, if you take one thing away from these different models, is every situation and every company that I've been involved in is inherently different. And you have to look at it strategically, and the Vidyard situation might change 3 years from now, right? And it's probably different than it was when you worked there,
yep.
Right?
And I want to address that point. So On to the point of changing, Mike, what's a catalyst for causing that change? What do you envision you changing the sales structure or the model anytime soon? Is there any point in time that you can see the need for having a dedicated BDR or sales development team versus AEs doing full cycle?
Well, I think customer acquisition cost is important. So our deal size on average is around 24K annually, and we look at things in MRR, right? So if it's $2,000 MRR, our CAC needs to be at a certain level. But also you want to look at what is the capacity for, in our case, a sales rep at ScribbleLive. And to be honest with everybody, we don't know what that is just yet. I knew what it was at my last two companies, but I don't know what the capacity for a ScribbleLive rep is. We have set objectives for bookings and for pipeline, and they're generally based on, you know, the standard of for every $4 of pipe you should be able to close $1 of bookings, but we don't actually know what the capacity is yet, and there needs to be time and data in place so that we can make a decision not based on what Vidyard does but based on what Scribble does.
That's actually a great point. And we go through constant changes like that, where it's like testing. So, you know, last year we were in a test of how many AEs can we hire without, you know, affecting their attainment rates, because we want 80% of them to hit their goal. And then this year it's like, okay, we got to slow down that a bit. Let's ramp up the BDR team so that everyone gets optimized. So you can find that efficiency per rep on the BDR side as well as on the AE side.
Cool. Let's jump into the fun stuff, hiring. And this one's going to go to you, Dan, because you had the pleasure of hiring me at Vidyard. I would say back then, so when I joined Vidyard, I was the first SDR, employee number 19. My interview process consisted of me coming in and Mike Litt, the CEO, asking me one of those Google questions. And then from then on, I pretty much had a job, or I just at least kept showing up. It was much more relaxed than I imagine what it is today. So can you give us a rundown of what a typical SDR goes through in the Vidyard interview process?
Yeah, for sure. And I think in those early days, like when you're only 19 people, you have to get along with everybody, right? So it was much more, do you have the drive to get us where we need to go? Do you believe in the company? Do you believe in what you're going to do with the company? Whereas now it's still that, but also, you know, I was talking about this earlier with another interview. We did an interview across the road before the session today. And, you know, somebody like Kenny was amazing to grow the company where it needed to go and made his way through the ranks very quickly. We actually, like, can't support that today because we have, you know, there's 20 other people ahead of you. And, yeah, you might be better than them, so you can skip a few. But if someone's equal to you, I can't just give you the job just because you're awesome at it. We have to, because we don't want to lose everyone else, right? We don't want to have them abandon ship. And so today what we do is we go through, you know, an initial interview with the BDR management just to see and make sure they know what they're doing, make sure they've done a bunch of research. What's really key is, have you actually put the effort forward? You know, we're hiring people fairly junior. So have you looked into what Vidyard is, who our customers are, why they would buy, what our value prop is? And if you haven't even looked into that, okay, you probably don't have the drive to really succeed. And there's a ton of candidates, you know, getting right out of school, people who are maybe in, you know, sales jobs at a telecom carrier or something and want to get into software. So that's the first stage. Once they've kind of proven themselves there, we actually send them a case study. And we say, here's a customer, here's a company. Here's what they are, here's what they do, here's what their website looks like. And we give them a real company. And we say, you know, on an SDR, so an inbound team, we give them the company and say, how would you respond to this based on what they've done on the website? So you get to test their business acumen to see if they can put themselves in the shoes of that person. So if the person you're reaching out to is a salesperson, don't talk to them about marketing pipeline, because unless it's an executive, they're not going to care. Put it in terms of how they're going to get better response rates, how they're going to get better qualification. If it's marketer, the opposite. So you kind of learn their business acumen through that response. If it's a BDR candidate, we actually don't give them the company, and we ask them, how would you figure out who to target, and then how would you target them? And in, like, we sell to B2B pretty much only, and it is amazing how many people, AEs as well as BDRs, will come and say, oh, Nike, because they have so many videos. And you're like, that, you don't quite understand what the value prop is, and it's a quick read through customer case studies. You're like, you don't get it. There's a guy in the crowd who brought a whole binder of questions and examples of how people would use it, and that's what we want to see, right? So he's made his way up. He's an account executive now, and that's the kind of drive we want to see, is that you understand business acumen, you've put yourself in the shoes of who that person is, and you've come prepared to interview properly.
Mm-hmm. What about assessing some of the softer skills around working with people, around maybe even some of the harder skills that are harder to do in an interview? So that could be cold calling, that could be emails, and you know, you show one example there, but I'm interested to hear more about how you assess someone's fit and some of the, you know, tougher skills in the interview process. So I'll start with you, Ilana, and then I'll move to Mike.
Our process has been, like, definitely evolved over time. Like I said before, we were focusing just on cold calling, right? So the interview was short, like, just, we did the project round as well. but what we really just focused on was, could they, you know, come in and do a fake cold call and then get our attention, and that was the end of it. Very, very short. If anything, it was, you know, between Steven and I would last, if anything, 6 minutes, 5 minutes. And we realized we definitely had to make changes since the role was evolving as well. So we still do the case study where they come in and do the project round. But it's like with me, I'm pretending to be an attorney. I'm very nice at it. I think you want me to be a little bit ruder when I do it, right? but they call, it's a full cold call, so they have to get to the value prop. From the value prop, we want them to try to get a little bit more attention. So try to run through some pain points, run through what we call like a mini demonstration. We're not looking for the presentation. We're just looking to see where the call goes. And that's where we're able to check out on the softer skills. Are they asking questions? Are they trying to tell us all the features, or are they actually going through value? And this is where we're able to tell who is actually, sales driven. Do they have that experience? Are they coming in asking the right questions? Or are they just trying to get the points of like, I know all the features. It doesn't really help, right, to ask those questions. So I think by building out these questions, the agility, like sometimes we can say, yeah, take your time to think about it. Don't ever listen to that in sales. Like, try to answer anything, something fast. And that's where I'm looking for that agility, right? People could have nerves. It's normal when they're coming in for interviews. But if we're hearing a lot of right? How easy is that to get rid of, right? When you're on the phone, it's even more nerve-wracking with a lawyer. Is that going to go? So we're looking for those skills, but we definitely know there's things that we can train on to get people better. And all sales, right? You learn a lot. So coaching is very key. But we're definitely looking for some of those skills now that the role has evolved.
So I'll turn to Mike now for that same question around hiring and maybe how the process evolved over time. But I want to add in another key piece there. For when I was interviewing at Vidyard, it's tough to develop those early skills, right? Cold calling, asking questions. You don't know what the role entails necessarily. So how much of that do you discount and say you can train that, or you can go through peer-to-peer, you can do onboarding, versus, you just kind of say, we can find a better candidate who may have, may innately be more curious or just be more comfortable talking on the phone?
Well, I think the two most difficult things for me and the folks that I've worked with.
Can people hear him? Just want to make sure.
Sorry. Feels like I should use your mic.
Yeah, sure.
That mic's not working very well. Yeah. Is that better? Yeah, it's better. So hiring and coaching are the two things that are, in my humble opinion, the most difficult. And they're the day-to-day grinded out things that don't get a lot of visibility in sales, but they're so critical to be able to scaling and getting a great team. Because if on the front end, if you're not hiring the same archetype and you're not testing and vetting for the same character attributes, then it's very hard for you to tell how someone and why an individual rep is being successful. So when I started at Scribble and the last three companies I've been at, the one thing that I'm fairly prescriptive about for our VP of sales and the folks that are doing the hiring is we have a very defined methodology that every single person, so I think we hired 7 new reps last month, and I think all of them are here, and they all went through the exact same process down to the T, and we all kind of track them against these attributes, and then a year from now, we're gonna go back and benchmark them and their success against those attributes so then we can go out and go get folks that exhibit those same tendencies. So we get them to do the similar things like a mock discovery call and all that good stuff. And we get them to do a fair amount of work, which really is kind of a squirrel catcher for the folks that don't want to do the work or aren't prepared to do the work, which is a key. So the two big things for me are coachability and work ethic. There's an innate intelligence that people are going to need to get to be in sales, but if they're not coachable and they don't have a strong work ethic, then they don't get to work at Scribble. And we actually test for that coachability. There's things built into the program that we try to tease out of people. And generally speaking, if there's any red flags around coachability, that's an immediate removal from the process. So I'd rather have someone who was very green, very intelligent, enthusiastic, and coachable than someone who thinks they know everything, because I don't know everything, and my VP of sales, who's here tonight as well, he doesn't know everything. So the guys that work for us, they got to have the same attitude. And girls that work for us.
Perfect.
Yeah.
So I want to jump into onboarding. I think I'm super passionate about it. I've seen a lot of companies do this wrong. They hire someone, they train them for a couple weeks, and they throw them on the phone, and they never talk to them again. So I want to specifically start with you, Ilana, because I'm familiar, and I think most people are familiar with, you know, marketing and sales tech because we use it consistently. But and they're more active on social. But I would say that lawyers are, you know, perceived as, you know, working in like an archaic industry, and so selling to them could be a totally different experience. And I think one of the things that startups especially get caught up on is peer-to-peer training versus top-down training. So training from you, training from Steven, from Ryan, and other folks. How do you manage to balance the two in the office?
Sure. It's funny, actually, because there are quite a few people in here who are lawyers. Can you stand up or make noise or did lawyer education or know a lawyer? Anything? I see hands.
Okay, four or five.
Yeah. So the people who are shy, they're shy right now. No, but they're the ones that came up to me first to introduce themselves. So actually, they're the nicest people in the room. So in terms of our training, it's two ways, right? Obviously, there's going to be the product training. There's going to be learning about the law itself. And then there's going to be the sales training. So I feel like the company, we do have a resident lawyer who's actually out of the Burnaby office. So there's some videos that have been created, Law 101, Law 102. So right away, in terms of the sales onboarding process, it's about 30 days where there's going to be some classroom style as well. I really am the one who digs into more of the sales training. So introduction with a gatekeeper, how to handle objections, how to have a great introduction with an attorney, how to keep interest, how to handle objections. There's like a name for every training that we do. And what's funny is I give it a month or two, we go right back and do it all over again. Right? Back to the basics. So my team will agree, we always go back to the basics. So there's a constant onboarding, but there's constant reminders of that training, right? We'll call people, they'll get hung up on, but we'll save the lead and maybe in 3 weeks put a task out to call it again, and they don't remember you, right? It's a great, it's like a fresh lead all over again, all the time. I'm sure all of you can attest to that, right? Yeah, I was just having an off day. Maybe they didn't like that rep, but now they like you.
How often do you consistently go back to the basics? Is it a monthly thing? Does it then turn into a quarterly or annual thing?
So what we're doing now with my team is we're changing the one-on-ones to be really data-driven. Know your number. Know, do you have a good show rate? Do you have a good conversion? What's your close rate? What's your percentage rate from a cold call? All those things. And they come into the meeting prepared. This is where I'm falling short. This is how I'm reading my stats. So based on it, they say to me, this is what I need. I know that I need more cold calling. I know I need a little bit of a reminder when it comes to talking with the gatekeeper. You know, I'm having a hard time. And it's hard, right? With the gatekeepers, female, male, you have to kind of be nice. You're not overly nice, but you have to have a different voice, right? It's like a server at a restaurant, right? It's a little, hi, it's a little nicer, right? Does anybody work at a restaurant? They know what I'm talking about. They go in the back. It's like, hey, how you doing? You go to your table. Oh, hi, good morning, good afternoon. Can I take your, it's very pleasant. So same thing, gatekeeper, a really nice conversation. Attorneys, it's all about don't waste my time. Get to your point faster. And a lot of training has to go on that. A nice conversation with the gatekeeper, let them remember you. Maybe there's 8 to 9 conversations with them before you actually get through. And when you actually get through, the whole training is different. That's where you gotta be a little bit more stern, get to the point. Right, guys? Yeah, okay.
Do you guys agree? Dan, I wanna specifically go to you because you've now taken over the team. And I obviously I wanna hear about what you're gonna do, but what wasn't working? You know, why are you coming to that role and making changes now? Because what failed previously?
Yeah, I think it's nothing that's failing necessarily. It's that the team grew to such a size that, you know, there was 3 different managers kind of all doing their own team well, but in slightly different styles. And so now it's like, how do we make sure that the whole company has a united front? We're all going after people in the same way, with the same messaging, with the same techniques, and also making sure that the individual team members, my 2 BDR managers are going to hold me accountable here. You know, they need more time in the day to work with their reps instead of dealing with all the internal shit, right? Like, well, how are these leads going to flow? And how is this operations going to work? And how are the AE relationships going? And how are they going to be organized? Like, that's what needed to be fixed. And that's why I took over the role. So we've actually looked externally for quite a while for the role. And there's not a lot of people who have necessarily done that. And if they have, you know, it might be somebody more like Mike who, you know, they're not interested in being business development director. They can head up an entire org. And so that's where I came in to take some of the business knowledge I've had over the past 4 years for Vidyard specifically and help organize it in a better way. Some of the stuff that was working really well, I think, is the BDR outbound messaging, the personalized videos that we're sending, the messaging they're using by persona. All of that stuff's going really well. Being tighter aligned to AEs is where they needed some help. So that's another reason I took over the role, is to help with my background on managing that side, to make sure the AEs are giving them the right feedback, giving them the right accounts, and making sure we're targeting the right people at the right time. And then secondarily is the inbound messaging, where, you know, they're just trying to deal with this huge funnel of inbound leads, and they're not being as personal as when I'm mm-hmm. trying to break into a market. Yeah. So that's where we need to to go into. Yeah. Our new demand gen director is pretty sick. I'm not gonna lie. She's out of Denver. Helped a bunch of other startups similar in the marketing space grow to huge sizes. So she's been doing a great job. It's just now our responsibility to increase those conversion rates.
Perfect, thanks. Mike, specifically around you, because once again, you have a different team structure, so I'm interested to hear how you manage that. And maybe what were some of the pitfalls that you saw as you joined Scribble and some of the tactics that you put into place to help with ongoing and onboarding?
Yeah, so I think some of these are universal truths and some of them are like my biases based on my experience, right? So when I got to Scribble, the sales force was geographically disparate relative to the size of the company. And so we had folks in Atlanta, and we had folks in Nashville, and we had folks in Los Angeles, and we had folks in New York, and they were all small clusters of relatively junior folks with less than 5 or 7 years sales experience that were kind of out in the wilderness on their own, right? And they came to Toronto and they did 2 weeks of onboarding, and then they were kind of left to their own devices with an RVP that maybe here in Toronto, or if they were lucky, was in their office, but they weren't too much more experienced than they were. So one of the things, and again, it may work for other folks out there, for our purposes at our time in the company's growth, was to repatriate, I guess, everybody back here. Because A, people don't need to get on the plane to do deals at Scribble. And B, we had a great sales leader already in Toronto that understood the business and aligned with my personal philosophy. And see, when you have folks that are just joining, there's a lot to be said. So the onboarding stuff is kind of table stakes, right? You bring them through, they get stuff from product, they get playbooks, they get a sales methodology. I mean, if you're a good company, you have that as table stakes, right? I think the individual nuances of what happens after that initial onboarding process is, do they have colleagues that they can trust who are maybe a little bit ahead of them? Do you have a defined coaching program where you've aligned them with a couple of senior folks and you can extend that onboarding beyond the first? So the first 6 weeks, in my experience, is people are getting their feet wet and you have a couple people that are opening ops and they're doing really well. And those are the folks generally you don't have to worry about. But it's that meaty part of the curve that it's the organization's management responsibility to make sure that they take the potential you saw in them when you hired them and turn it into something tangible of them being successful, right? So that again gets back to when I talked about hiring and coaching being the two critical things. Onboarding is, in my opinion, an offshoot of that, and it's a set of steps that you need to take them through. But the devil's in the details. If you're willing to do those monthly meetings with someone where you're like, man, I don't want to get on another discovery call to help this person's conversion rate in terms of their, you know, their MQLs to SQLs, but I know that that's going to make them better down the road, and I know that that's going to turn our team into a more high-functioning team. So I don't know if that's technically onboarding, but I see, you know, our new reps onboarding it being the first year, right? It's not just the first couple of weeks or the first month or the boot camp for 2 weeks, right? So
I've got a follow-up to that if you want. So that was another thing we talked about earlier, about how, you know, the team's such a size now that you can't just be an AE in 6 months like you maybe could at a smaller company. And so what we've done on that point is, you know, your onboarding is almost 18 months, and it's not necessarily, we don't call it onboarding, but we call them micro tiers within the sales development team. Yeah. So it's, you know, you start as a concierge one, you're dealing with all the act now. Oh, you're doing really well, and, you know, you're knowing how to get people to SQL. Okay, let's try you actually receiving some inbound, but also trying to reach out to people cold. Okay, you've done really well there. Now you can, you know, move up to BDR where you're doing entirely cold, mixed with a little bit of inbound when we need you. And then you go up and there's actually five tiers to go through where you have increasing responsibility for coaching the team, onboarding, being a mentor. Now that was another thing that we had to look at was how do we make sure that you're not only learning from your mentor, because, you know, Kenny's a very outgoing person. Maybe we hire somebody who's not. And if they're mentee under Kenny, like, they're not going to learn, they're not going to know how to do it. And so that's where we've built some standardized onboarding and making sure, like, it's table stakes to make sure everyone's got the same skills and the same templates and the same cadence review so that they know 6 months from now when they're struggling, like, well, you all had the same training and your mentee brought these things up along the way.
Yeah. And that's a bit of a different topic, but it kind of dovetails into the notion of, I love the idea of giving folks, because if you hire good, ambitious people, let's say at a BDR level, 18 months, that person's got to move up or out in their own mind, right? So if you give them levels to aspire to that are not just made up, but the company needs to grow to support that, but it needs to be a tangible difference in their responsibility or a tangible difference in their income or whatever it might be, that, because let's face it, most of the folks in sales, we like to hire people, you know, less about the old adage of being coin operated and more about the adage of, I want to be successful. I'm a competitive person by nature, and that competition and that success is what I'm striving for. And if you hire those kind of folks, they tend to be a little bit more high maintenance than if they weren't that way. But it's a good thing. You want to foster that high maintenance, right? But you do that by putting structure in place and not just giving them everything they want, but giving them, there's the next rung on the ladder, and here are the five things you need to do to get to the next rung on the ladder. So at Scribble, it's still early days for us, but we're starting to put in, we have a couple of guys who are senior relative to the team, and they have a different set of responsibilities. Some of them are implied, and some of them are actually spelled out for them. But it's amazing the response that they've made to the new guys, right? So I think, it gets back to the first thing. Are you hiring the right archetype, right? Yeah.
I don't know if I'm going way off topic, but exactly what you're saying. A lot of salespeople, and correct me if I'm wrong, believe that if they become really, really good at sales, they're going to get promoted into a management position. And after a lot of thought and a lot of feedback on this, it's not always the right thing. A good salespeople or a good salesperson earlier in their career has a lot more to see in their sales career. Maybe they're starting with SMB. Maybe they need to move into more of the larger scale, then to work into relationship building, then they work into the enterprise level. And then they, you know, that's where they can keep going. And if they decide at that point, they've gotten all the experience to move into a management role if they choose to. And that's something I've learned over the last couple of years as well. It's like, you're good sales, you should be a manager. But then once you're a manager for a couple of years, you can't get back into sales. And I know a lot of people like that, right? They are like, well, I was a sales manager, and now I want to go back and be a sales rep. Yeah. You didn't get the job.
And the sales story is like, this is not as glamorous as I thought it was going to be, right?
Yeah.
Like, I have to manage all these crazy personalities, and I don't actually take the ball over the goal line. I have to have other people taking it over the goal line for me. It's a big change for some people, right?
Let's jump into sales tech. It's a hot topic right now. There's a myriad of different technology, and I think actually all three of you are using SalesLoft, if I'm not mistaken.
No.
So, you know, as an SDR, as
nope.
even an AE, you're not using SalesLoft?
No. Nope.
Okay. So two of the three are using SalesLoft. I'm sure you guys are using other tools.
Yes.
Other sales tech tools. So, you know, how does an SDR and AE really separate themselves, or how can they be more creative, given that some of these tools are extremely prescriptive in, you know, cadences, or all the messaging is written out for them, it's all templates. What do you guys do to kind of allow for a bit of creativity, and how do you mix, because all of you I think have said personability, you know, personalized emails, videos, how do you mix the two between having messaging that you know works, but also letting the rep be a bit more creative in their outreach?
Yeah, this is actually perfect timing, so we're just implementing a standardized cadence yesterday. Why? So the why was, there is a huge spread of conversion rates in the BDR org. So some people convert at a 1.5% rate from MQL, SAL technically. Some convert at 6. So that's like a 4x conversion. It's crazy. And so we had to look at, okay, what are these people doing differently? Review a bunch of messaging, see what they're sending, see what kind of response rates they're getting and on which emails, subject lines, like all that stuff. And you can see some direct things. It's part of the, maybe they got onboarded by a certain AE who does like this crazy whacked, hyper complex cadence, which is awesome. But when you're new, you don't have a lot of business acumen, are you gonna be able to manage that? Like, do you understand the difference between a sales operations manager and a revenue operations manager? Do any of us? Like, you can't get that in depth, and so they were just getting lost. And so what we did is, we're not forcing the people who are converting high rates to switch over. We're looking at, okay, how can we make you more successful? You've only been here 6 months, you don't seem to be, you know, doing quite as well as the others. Why don't I help you be more successful and get that 6% conversion rate? We've taken all the top people's cadences, we've looked at them, we've evaluated their subject lines, their methodologies of, you know, high touch, high personability versus low, and kind of built that into a standardized cadence, certain length, certain touch points and time between, and built that in. Now you can't, it's not just templates, you can't just send. So as an example, the first email is actually a video using our own product, viewed it, where they're explaining to that person, you know, I reached out because I really think we could help with your sales effectiveness, or we could help with creating more pipeline from your marketing programs that use video. And they're using a personal video to reach out. So it's templated in a way that we kind of give them a loose script, but they have to base it on that persona they're reaching out to and something relevant in their LinkedIn profile or on their website. So that's the first touch. Second touch, bit of an easier touch for the individual. They don't have to personalize quite so much themselves. We've built persona-based templates where they just personalize the first line. So they still get to be themselves, reference maybe a Twitter post that somebody did or something on their LinkedIn in the first line, but the rest of the emails are all roughly based around that persona, their title. And it goes that way kind of back and forth between a really highly personalized email that includes video usually and a lower personalized email that's based on persona. So personalized by persona takes them less time. And obviously there's calls mixed in throughout. We don't penalize people if they start changing that. It's, hey, if you can change that and build something more complex and get an 8% response rate bonus, we'll look at that, maybe build it in. We don't force you on that, but if you're veering away and going back down to 2%, you know, get back on that standardized cadence, and it's proven to work.
Yes, this is a bit of a tough one for me. We use SalesLoft at Scribble. And our VP of sales ops and our VP of sales kind of led the charge to put it in. I often worry, I think sales automation, if it hasn't already, will quickly become kind of the scourge of sales in general as a profession, in the sense that customers get more and more acclimated to the different strategies that you see, right? And the first couple times you use them, so I was talking to somebody tonight who runs inside sales for 24/7, and he's using a specific strategy and a tactic that's really working. So I think it's analogous to 7 or 8 years ago, or maybe 8 or 9 years ago, the use of content marketing to generate leads was, the first couple years that we used it, we saw exponential increases across the board in the early part of the funnel. Now, again, I hate to use that word, but it's table stakes, right? So now a sales loft cadence is kind of, everyone has a sales loft cadence, right? Especially if your deal size is lower than 24K or 20K. So I think having a great product and having customers that are willing to advocate on your behalf, either directly or indirectly, becomes kind of one of the only real kind of points of differentiation, right? And then if you have a creative salesperson that can go beyond, this is what my sales manager wants me to do as a cadence, but I know what works and I can prove that it works within my micro market that I'm working in, then I think those are the things that make the difference. But yeah, do we use SalesLoft to automate the process of the 7 to 10 touches that you need to make to follow up on an MQL? For sure, but I don't think it really sets us apart, right? Those other things set us apart. Or we try to make sure they set us apart.
So I'm going to backtrack a bit, back to the training and onboarding. You said something interesting there, Mike, was if you're a creative salesperson, I think all the salespeople here are like, yeah, I'm creative, or I'd like to be creative. How can I be more creative? How can I increase my conversion rates, close more, just generate more pipe, whatever the case is. And, on to be on theme here about personability and empathy, what we find is people can easily get desensitized, right? They're behind a screen all day, they're behind a phone. So I want to just dive into some of the more tactics you're doing around trying to create empathy within your team. Know that you're talking to another person on the other end of the line. You want to be respectful of their time. What tactics are you doing to teach your reps about who's on the other end of the phone or the computer screen? We'll start with Mike and then we'll move down.
Sure. So, sorry, just so I understand, you create empathy from rep to customer or sales manager to rep?
Rep to customer. And if not, why not?
Yeah, I think again, the sales context and the nuance of who you're selling to. So I would imagine, you know, Ilana, when you mentioned you were selling to lawyers who get paid by the hour, you can't chat with them, right? Whereas at my last organization, we sold one of our segments with credit unions and higher education institutions. So those folks don't want you to get to the point. They don't, you know, if you're running the student services department at, you know, Kentucky Community College, you're not really interested in, and nor is your personal driver cost savings or revenue generation, right? So I think really understanding the sales context and the nuances of what's important to your customer segment, I think one of the biggest things in sales is understanding the personal driver of your prospect, right? And trying to understand, you know, everybody does things for personal reasons, right? Everybody came here tonight for a specific reason that generally fits what they want to do, either career-wise or maybe they're here to prospect or whatever it might be, looking for a new job, looking to find a new customer, whatever, looking to educate themselves. They all have personal drivers. I think the best salespeople I've ever worked with and for and have worked for me, they have laser focus into understanding what that is and then giving the person that. And I think that's, in my mind, the definition of empathy, right? Not wasting your customer's time by speaking to them in their language and talking to them about things that matter to them.
Just to add to that as well, I think for my reps, like, they're dialing 80 to 100 dials a day, where 50 of those calls are going to be straight hangups. So for them, it could be a bit different when you're finally doing a demo. They love it. They're finally talking to someone who wants to listen to them. And like all sales DNA, you want to help, right? At the end of the day, you're selling something. Believe it or not, there is a DNA that we as salespeople are selling something to help our prospects, right? So I think the most important thing is to think about the empathy on all the hangups. Right? What can I do for my reps that allows them to get up, take a walk for a minute, right? Go for a tea, go for a coffee, set up some mini golf, or just do something different. But for them, when they're finally on that demo, that's where the sale happens. And it could take every other day to get on the phone. It could take longer. So I think that's where, I mean, every position is different, but they want that part of the call, right? And then from back to the sales tools is getting them away from the computer to say, let's break down that call together. And we can get into a whole different conversation of what we're using for that, but that's where we can get away from the computer screen as well after those demos.
What are you using for that?
Gong. Have you heard of it?
Yes.
Okay, there we go.
Okay, so a couple rapid fire questions before we open up Q&A for the audience. You know, whether this is a misconception or it's a stereotype, are Canadians perceived as being too nice in the sales process? I mean, some of you have sold to Americans, you know, you have U.S. territories, some of you had Canadian territories, and you see, you know, the distribution in your organizations. Is it bullshit? Is it a competitive advantage?
I think it depends on the company culture. So I would say at Vidyard, no. Like, some people maybe even reply saying, hey, like, fuck off, we're done. Because we are making sure that we're being relevant to them and reaching out with some nugget that helps them each time, but it is still going through that full 8 to 10 touches. So it's not like we're backing down when they, you know, don't respond or don't even open or respond saying, like, maybe not right now. It's like, well, typically with your role, I see, you know, you focused on these three things. Are these any of these a focus right now, just so I know what is relevant to send you? So we're pretty aggressive, and I would say it is based on the culture of the company. I've seen some other ones in Kitchener, especially like once you get out of the large cities, that can be a bit more laid back, a bit more just kind of relying on natural growth as opposed to kind of going out there and finding the business. But in general, I would say if you're in this room, you're probably not one of those Canadians being too nice.
Yeah. Mike?
I've never had... I think Americans, if I'm generalizing, have a preconceived notion of what Canadians are like. And for whatever reason, I wasn't actually even born in Canada, but I've lived here for most of my life, but everyone picks up on my accent. So almost every American I've ever sold to, they go, you're from Canada. And then they quickly go to, okay, wait a minute, especially if the deal size is big, do you have other offices outside of Canada? Because I don't really don't know where that is, and I don't know what goes on there. So do you have an office in New York, or do you can say you have an office in Virginia, which, you know, in some place that nobody here would want to go to for longer than 3 days, but they think I get in my dog sled and I go to work every day, right? In the fourth largest city on the continent, right? So I think that's a preconceived notion or bias that we as Canadians selling into the U.S. and let's face it, if we want to grow our software companies, we have to sell into the U.S., right? It's 10 times what this market is, so we have to get past that. And if we have to get past it with offices that happen to be in the U.S., then we do it that way. But I never got the perception of nicety, I just got the perception of, you know, where is Toronto and, you know, how many people live there and what kind of food do you guys eat and, you know, weird stuff like that. Yeah.
Cool. Ilana, just that same question to you. If you feel differently or you've had different experiences or you just...
No, I think there's a seller and there's a buyer and anywhere you go, right? And you're going to have great sales reps who can, you know, overcome early objections and create a really good sense of a conversation, or you need to work on it. Right? If it's American, if it's Canadian, I don't think there's a difference. I think it could be an excuse, but a sales rep can be strong or not. And those to me would just be excuses.
Steven's proud of that answer. It's a tough answer.
Thank you, Steven, for that.
Great. Last question, then we'll move to Q&A. I'm personally interested in this one. This one came up in a group that I'm in around salespeople having calls in public versus going to the call room and, you know, doing call by themselves. On one hand, it can be loud on the sales floor. On the other hand, you get that peer-to-peer learning. So how do your organizations do it? Do you allow reps to kind of go as they wish? Do you have them on the sales floor? Just want to go one by one. We'll start with you, Ilana.
I'll start with that too. For my team, it's all done on the floor. And what I believe is that they prefer that. There's a lot of times where if I see a rep, imagine a rep on my team being in a room alone, I could see knocking on the glass door, like, help, somebody come and help me, right? Or get on the phone. But that's the environment, right? We can walk over, a lot of the reps help one another out. But I could see on a larger scale, if it's on the AE side, a lot of those, the planning of those deals will go with maybe a rep. It could be with the director of sales as well. So I think it really all depends on the sales size and the deal and how much, and if, you know, it's too noisy. It really depends. I'd like to hear the insight from the rest of them too.
Yeah, for sure. So we have a very open office. It almost looks exactly like this. Our desks have kind of a 1 foot divider that blocks nothing between one another. Small desks, about, 5 foot desk facing each other. So, you know, the way I look at it is some people are comfortable calling at their desk. That's great. Some people on our team are very loud and should be in a call room locked away because it affects six people, right? So the way we look at it is we don't care where you make the calls. Obviously, there's a time and a place to do calls, and maybe at your desk. That's completely fine. A lot of our reps on the prospecting side will choose to do it at their desks. We've also, though, you know, and this came from Steve, our COO, from Hootsuite, is he loves the open office, but he also believes of like a 3 or a 2-to-1 ratio to meeting rooms, a call room. They're very small, they're 3x4, they're enough to fit you, a desk, your laptop, a phone. We're working on how hot they are right now, but they are there. And it is okay if you wanna make those calls and you are just too distracted when other people are talking around you, you need to go there, that's completely fine. But we are open, you know, we've raised the barriers so that there is a bit more privacy and you can still hear one another. It's not that, it's the distraction. When you're sitting across from somebody, I'll pick on Jordan here, and you catch an eye and he's doing something funny and then you're like, what discovery question was I asking? What line of, like, where am I? And especially on the account executive side, a lot of them will choose to do demos and things in room because if they get sidetracked like that, you know, mid pitch on a certain product line or a certain use case they see with that customer, it can be kind of detriment to the deal. So we're definitely open to both and don't have set rules, but we have started creating more rooms to, as the team grows, to allow them that experience, because we do want to make sure the calls, you know, maybe not 80 a day, that's amazing, but you know, getting up 30, 40 still takes up a lot of the day, and if you're not comfortable,
day,
you're
really?
Never going to do it.
Yeah, 80.
Good for you.
Minimum.
So, great, we can continue this aside. I just, I want to add on to Dan's, to Dan, just a follow-up question. It's common, at least in my experience too, you know, running to a room, pretending you're doing calls and then just sending emails is the easiest thing to do, right? It's your safe space. And on the other hand, having calls wide open allows for newer reps, people on the SDR, BDR team to listen to some of these, conduct their calls. So I guess my point is, do you not think of those things? Does that not happen? Do reps not go there to hide, you know, to hide from, avoid taking those calls or doing any of those calls?
We track everything in Salesforce, so that's pretty tightly tracked. The other thing we try to do to allow for the learning, in case there is certain people who aren't comfortable, is a lot of call, not necessarily call blitzes, but with your mentor or with your manager a lot, we'll get into a room, you know, not a 3x4 room with another person, but a small room to make a bunch of calls back and forth and make feedback on one another, because that is a great way to learn. And when you're at your desk, you're not necessarily always listening to the person next to you, because if you're at your desk, you should probably be doing what you're supposed to be doing. So that feedback doesn't always work at the desk and should almost be done in a coaching session, whether it's 1-to-1 or 4-to-1, or like, it doesn't always have to be just 1-to-1 like that.
Yeah, I think the culture dictates the approach or the methodology, but you can't have it both ways. So a lot of software companies are, it's changing a little bit, but they're run by either accountants or engineers who may not have real world experience selling. So they're just like, oh, just give these guys a space, right? Or we don't want them being so loud. And you say, well, would you like them to sell something or would you not? Or would you everyone like to go home, right? Because if we don't sell anything, then we all don't have jobs, right? That's on a bad day. On a good day, I might phrase it differently. But I think that, you know, being sensitive to being okay, creating a culture where it's okay to mess up, right? Where you make a joke out of someone getting hung up on or someone screwing up a call, right? And you come over and say, man, you really fucked up that call, didn't you? And then they feel like it's okay because we all do it, right? And we want to get that out of the way as soon as is humanly possible so that people feel comfortable. And then it becomes, those screw ups become less and less, and that comfort level gets higher, because once you go past a threshold of that person being scared to be themselves in the open area, then you've kind of lost them, right? And then just one more thing before I stop. So Janik and Jack and Alex, can you guys stand up for a second? These are three now. Ilana, can you say, how many calls do your reps make again a day?
A minimum of 80.
It's 80, fellas, 80.
I think we just lost three people for the next sales event. So, Mike, I'm going to need you to promote it for the next one. Yeah, find another three people. Okay, yeah. Great. Thank you, guys. This was amazing. I hope everyone here walked away with, you know, one piece of learning. We're going to open the floor up to some questions. So we have another 10, 15 minutes of questions, and then, you know, we'll let everyone get on with their day. But let's start it up. We'll start with this side of the room, and then we'll kind of move over there. So questions, start with you.
So you're talking more sales development versus account executive, that kind of thing?
Just going to repeat the question. How quickly should you specialize your salespeople to SDRE?
I think that's back to what Mike said at the beginning. It really depends on the product, the sales process, the sales model. Everyone's going to be different. Mm-hmm. For Vidyard specifically, we were very small. I started when we were 10 people. Kenny said he was 19. That's probably your official employee number. He worked for free for about 5 months. That's a free tip right there. So he probably started soon after me, and you know, we didn't necessarily need the role yet, but he came to an event, really impressed us with what he wanted to do. And while he was finishing up school, he was like, hey, go to town, like find some customers for us. Because it's not like the account executives' calendars were full. So we actually found that this was more beneficial, and with his proven success and another guy named John, you know, we instantly started hiring that team bigger, because at that point there was two AEs, and then we hired a third one pretty quickly, and you know, we could prospect, or we could get guys on the sales development team to prospect for us and fill our calendar, and you know, their pay is lower. So they're able to fill a calendar of a guy who maybe is six figures for half the price. And so that's why we effectively did that. It's very different if you have, you know, an influx of inbound leads. Okay, maybe it doesn't make sense to specialize yet, because your AEs have time to respond to those, and it's not like they're beating their heads against a wall going outbound. So you may not need that. It just depends on your process.
Anything to add? Does anyone disagree? Perfect. Questions? Open it up. Any other questions here? Dan.
So you guys talked a bit about your territory plans and being round robin and a bit of geographic. Have you thought about going vertical, so focused on industries, and when do you make that switch?
So if you thought about changing your territory to be more vertical based, and if not, when should you make that type of switch?
So for me, this may sound a bit repetitive. It has everything to do with what you're selling and who you're selling to. So at Scribble, we are a content marketing platform, so it is a very broad market that includes B2B and B2C. There are segments or verticals within that broader market, but they tend to consume and use the product the exact same way. The last organization I was at, folks cared about whether you knew how a health insurance company operated as it pertains to using your software relative to a higher education institution or a telco. So I think if your product lends itself to specialization, giving you a sales advantage, and it also gets back to the specialization question that gentleman asked initially, is you got to start at the beginning, right? It's the worst thing in the world is if you guys are at a company and says, our only problem is we need to hire more sales reps. It's probably not your only problem. You probably have a problem way back when you decided who your target market was and who the core persona was and how you were going to deliver value or solve a pain point for them. So going back to what that is, and does it lend itself naturally to a vertical-based segmentation? If it does, do it. If it doesn't, don't do it.
Yeah, I'll add to that, because that is key. If the buyer doesn't need you to be specifically knowledgeable about their industry, you don't have to do it early. If it's very like that, like Salesforce, I know, split out healthcare, life sciences, and fintech very early because it's a different language. Like, they need to understand advisors versus customers versus sales reps. Like, just different language, and you had to talk that way. With our platform, we're very similar to Scribble. It helps a little bit in financial services. So we have some people who kind of specialize that way, but we don't route everything to them. And then what we do is we wait for what I call cellular division. It's similar to what we look at when we're looking at international expansion, is if there's enough of a base, if you're seeing like a quarter of your business being financial services and it's growing faster than the other parts of the business, let's create a team specific to that. Good example, we have something coming out right now where it's Service Cloud, an entirely different talk track, entirely different buyer in the support organization versus marketing and sales, which we've been dealing with before. So we'll be creating a team dedicated to that. They'll help out some of the current AEs, but they'll be focused on building their own division because it's an entirely different buyer. You know, if we're selling to Salesforce, who's been a customer for the last 5 years, the service department probably doesn't know the sales department. So there's no crossover there. We're selling to an entirely different person. Whereas sales and marketing, we're all pretty tightly aligned, you'd hope anyway. So we don't need to specialize there. And financial services marketing isn't that much different than other marketing. So until we see a need that there is a big enough growth there, we won't specialize industry-wide.
Just want to ask a follow-on question for you, Dan. For Salesforce specifically, at least when I was there were AMs, account managers, that dealt with upsells, renewals. Is that still the case, or?
Yeah, you're talking about Vidyard, though.
Yeah.
You said Salesforce.
No, for selling to Salesforce.
Oh, selling to Salesforce. So they have now expanded to their sales enablement, their sales consultants, and are now looking this year to expand to their actual sales team.
I meant for Vidyard selling to Salesforce.
Yeah.
Is that a new deal selling to the Service Cloud, or is that an upsell counted by an AM?
By the accounting term, it's an upsell, but essentially it's an entirely new deal. You're using your your current customer buyer to leverage that. We don't have account management anymore, so it's an account executive that owns the account, and then a customer success manager that deals with the day-to-day. And so for Salesforce, the account executive that deals with them, he's actually our sales leader and CEO because of the relationship there over the years, is now going down with our VP of customer success to talk to the customer success and the customer support side of things. And it's, you know, they know that they're a customer already, but it's an entirely new business case, an entirely new platform need, and an entirely different subset of videos too.
Thanks. Move it over. Lear, yeah.
So,
speak up.
This might be a little bit off topic, but when you think about growing your sales force, right, and let's say at a certain point you were constrained in terms of resources, in terms of your ability to train and hold people's hand, how effective is video and audio and things like that for them to kind of get acquainted with how to improve their sales process? To give you some context, I own a real estate brokerage. There's a bunch of agents in Toronto that are absolute garbage. We can't hold everyone's hand through the sales process. I'm wondering whether we can leverage some of those, techniques in terms of audio and video to improve, but I don't know in terms of, how successful it's been in tech. Maybe it's applicable in this context as well.
Yeah, I'll cover two examples. So,
can you repeat the question, Dan?
Yeah, so the question is how effective is using video when you're onboarding salespeople or other when your time is too constrained? You can't focus on actually onboarding and going through a full boot camp. So to be honest, until probably 8 months ago, whoever started recently can tell me, all of our onboarding and training was done via video. We're Vidyard though, so it'd be good to hear what these guys' opinions are after. Because we are entirely video-based, and it was basically recordings. We have a weekly Vidyard sales academy that we go through, which is different topics on how to be a good salesperson, and we just recorded all of them, similar to what we're doing here, and they were just available, and I had a schedule of each day you had to do certain courses and go through them. We're Vidyard, we can track if you actually watched it. We had a knowledge base check at the end of every day to make sure you kind of understood the concepts, because it was, I was the only leader, there was 16 people, there's no way I'm spending 2 weeks just helping onboard somebody. So it was effective for us, but we definitely found some shortcomings there. If you don't hire like a rock star who knows exactly what they're doing, there's gonna be a lot of stuff missing that you get during that one-on-one coaching, during that boot camp for a week with your sales enablement person. And we do basically a week of the sales manager onboarding and then a week of sales enablement onboarding, which is more persona-based and how to target the sales process and all that. Without that today, I think it would be a struggle. It's just in the early days, we were hiring a bit slower so we could make sure we're picking somebody who just knows what they're doing. We know them. I knew Ellen from Salesforce, so we hired her. Didn't have to really onboard her. It was like, here's some videos and you can go. So it just depends on what your model is, really. Do you have any experience in that sense?
Yeah, it sounds, and again, I hate to make an assumption, but it sounds like you might have a sales ops problem, not a sales people problem. Generally speaking, the folks that get you over those first couple of hurdles tend to have certain personality traits, right? So they're self-starters and they tend to figure it out no matter what. And then when you scale past 4 or 5 sales reps, you need to move into operationalizing the process of onboarding and training and educating those folks so that you can again speak to the middle part of that trend, right? Of the folks that are average, not the folks that are exceptional, because they're very hard to find. And if you find them, hang on to them. But once you get past 4 or 5 reps, eventually you're going to get to a point where the bulk of your reps are average. And if the bulk of your reps are average, those reps need to be equipped with the tools they need and the education they need and the coaching they need in order to generate above average results. So it feels like, just not knowing, that it sounded like you were frustrated with the reps' performance, when really it's kind of the average you're talking about. And you may have been lucky early on with a smaller group of reps, But in my mind, sales ops starts at maybe 4 or 5 reps, right?
Which is earlier than I've heard. Terms of the tools you use to educate them, though, in that sense, do you use anything today, particularly on video or audio? Are there any specific tools that have worked well for you in this process to complement the hand-holding approach or being there face-to-face?
Yeah, I think video is a great tool. We have a new sales consultant or sales engineer that started, and the person previous to them did a great job of kind of documenting real world examples of how they would walk a customer through a demo or walk them through a more complex engagement. So I think being able to freeze those moments in time and then being prescriptive for folks to be able to see it live is different than, hey, read this page on the feature sets of the product and be able to communicate what they are. So yeah, I think video is a great thing. Great thing, yeah.
Anything to add to that, Ilana?
Yeah, I could say that we're definitely still growing when it comes to having that sort of content. When it comes to the product, we definitely have our other Burnaby office who is more on top of when it comes to the product training, walking our new reps through, especially now with the AE program, they're walking them through mock demos all the time. So that's really helpful. Maybe I'm a bit old school. Maybe I should really, you know, listen to these guys a bit more. But I like the classroom style of sales training, right? I like the excitement of sitting with a new rep and teaching them how to get through talking to a gatekeeper, you know, listening to some calls, creating a library through our sales enablement, right? Like creating a library of what is a good example of a call, get them to break it down. What might be a bad example, play it, get them to pinpoint those issues out. So I think I'm a bit more of a hand holder, but again, it's a new process and working with 11 people, I can still do that right now. Growing the team and seeing it double or triple, yeah, we're gonna have to go to a different training model.
6 months, we'll come back to this and we'll see how that's worked out.
So I'm invited back, okay.
Last question.
Yeah, I like
the
calls.
Please repeat the question.
Okay, what's more successful is what I thought. Is it the calling cold or is it email? It's very easy to respond to an email. I'm not interested. It's harder to do that on the phone. When you get that I'm not interested, they don't have something else to say. That's like all lawyers sat in a room and said, let's start with I'm not interested, right? And then when they get by that, what do we do next? I guess we should hear them out. Right? So in my opinion, the email is an easy target to be, I'm not interested, and block it. A good way, you know, sometimes even before a meeting, we don't email and say, okay, are you ready for 2 o'clock? Oh, something came up. Right? So the phone calls I find are the best. You catch them off guard. They're there. They want to hear you out for a minute. It's a strong call, strong process.
I wish we could do that. Unfortunately, in our market, when we're selling to sales, is much easier. So we're getting more into calling now with our sales product line and selling to sales executives. On the marketing side, as an example, the entire marketing team at Vidyard, there's 25 of them downstairs. Not a single one has a phone. Not a single one is paid for by Vidyard to have a cell phone. So it's literally like you've got to call the front desk, but they can't route them. They physically don't have a phone. So there's actually no way to get a hold of them on the phone. So we still do, you know, drop voicemails. We're, you know, adding some value there so that when we do reach out via email, they know that we're being empathetic to what they are. We're being personal to reaching out to them, and hopefully you get a higher response rate based on that. But unfortunately, you know, probably at most 10% of our qualified ops every month come from a call, a cold call. Obviously, everyone comes from a call because at some point you get on the phone with them. But that cold call is at most 10% of what we find.
Yeah, I think the phone is the most useful mechanism for two-way communication that's kind of authentic if you can get folks. I think nothing trumps having an authentic belief that you can solve a problem for the customer. And then it's just a matter of when, not if, right? When you get the right opportunity to educate them on this opportunity or this problem that you can solve for them. One of the first things that I find with new reps who's at their first job either as a BDR or as a sales rep is they're often puzzled why they leave 40 voicemail messages and they have none when they get back the next day, and you have to convince them it's not their job to call you back. So I don't know if anyone in this room, if you ever get a call back from a prospect, I'd like to hear from you. Like, well, I don't know what you did, but if your prospect actually called you back, man, you should take a bow, because that just never happens, right? And it's almost like a
it's like for me, if someone's selling to me, it's like a test, right? It's a personal, like, I'm not going to call, I want to see how much you honestly believe that you have a value prop, right? And the other thing I would say is there's nothing, I find it's no archetype easier to sell to than a salesperson because they feel your pain a little bit, right? The problem is they're mostly they're tire kickers, right? Because they feel bad and they don't want to say, you know, it doesn't work for us. But anyway, I don't know if that answers the question, but yeah.
Being persistent, I guess, is common amongst everyone. Yeah. Cool. So I want to be respectful of our panelists' time and everyone here. I want to thank you guys for coming out. This was fantastic. So round of applause for our panelists today.